MashaAllah, assalamu alaikum. Guys, mashaAllah, I'm so happy to be seated here, this beautiful place here. We're in London with the mashayikh and the brothers, and I'm happy to be attending and participating in some of the beautiful work that's happening here, man. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. So with us is Sheikh Wael Ibrahim, Sheikh Abu Bakr Zul, Akhi Ayman, mashaAllah, tabarakAllah, Sheikh Adnan, and we just went to one event that was National Waqf event, where I delivered a little talk about the connecting of the Ummah and, you know, how we should be, alhamdulillah. But Sheikh Wael, it's your first time in the UK. Tell us more about how you felt coming here.
Allahu Akbar, alhamdulillah. So glad. Actually, my highlight so far is meeting people that I have loved for the sake of Allah way before I even come to meet them. Another Minki brother, mashallah, Sheikh Adnan Mink, Sheikh Abu Bakr Zud, mashallah, tabarakallah. I love you guys for the sake of Allah. And Allahu Akbar, the man that reminds me of me.
Apart from the pornography side.
Thank you so much. Yes, so I was saying, Sheikh Adnan, how has your trip been so far, man?
MashaAllah. Alhamdulillah. It's my first time coming here in December, meeting Sheikh Bakr Zud. My first time actually attending your motivational event, and my first time attending Light Upon Light. MashaAllah.
Amazing. So this is the first time to attend lectures for you outside Zimbabwe.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. Yeah, MashaAllah. Obviously, alhamdulillah, we've been on the road with Akhi Ayman. We've had the masjid tour. It's been amazing. I've learned a lot from him, a lot from all the mashayikh who've been around, a lot from the people who've attended. It was lovely seeing the youth around. And alhamdulillah, I look forward to learning more from all the mashayikh who are here, our seniors, our teachers, etc.
You know, with me, just to put things into perspective, as you know, my family is all from here, basically. The bulk of my family, so my wife, my kids, a lot of them, and some of them even live here, so I come quite often. And what happens is, wherever I go, if I go to a masjid, they'll ask me to lead the salah. They'll ask me to say a few words. If my kids want to go for a program, and as I enter, they'll say, no, Sheikh, you have to speak. And because of the profile, sometimes you have to let them know that I'm coming to this place. So when you let them know, they'll advertise, say, oh, Sheikh Mink is coming, you know, he's gonna say a few words, sometimes without even asking you, and sometimes asking you. So it's amazing. So as much as sometimes people think this is Mufti Mink's event, but I'm just a guest at my own event, you know, at an event that now became mine simply because I wanted to attend it. So that's why I sit and listen to Sheikh Wael Ibrahim, Sheikh Abu Bakr Zod. Akhi Ayman doesn't like me to say this, but you know, we sit and listen sometimes to what they have to say, because the new generation, they know more about how gangsters operate and all of that, mashallah. So it's a good thing. And they give all the kids a lot of good words. Sheikh Abu Bakr, you've been here before?
Yes, I came here about 2 months ago.
Allah, not too bad.
2 months ago. We had an event with Akhi Ayman
Amazing,
as well.
Amazing, mashallah. Yeah.
There was a conference about the journey of the soul. So that was my first time here. I spent about 10 days. And this is the second time now.
Yeah, there's a lot of Muslims here, mashallah. Yeah. And there's a lot of people keen on the deen, even from among the non-Muslims. And you know what's a good thing? For them to see inside the circle of Muslims how exactly the Muslims behave and so on. A lot of the times you have people from outside who hate on Islam, and they present, confusions, and sometimes they literally tell lies at times about what the Muslims are like. When you come within and you listen, oh, this is a Muslim event. A lot of non-Muslims come to some of these events. And so it's a good opportunity for them to see from the inside. But Akhi Ayman, tell us about the dawah and how it works. And tell us about the young people and the challenges they face.
Bismillah ar-Rahman, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala Muhammad. First and foremost, wallah, it's a great pleasure to be amongst the mashayikh. And there's a lot to learn. But to be honest, there is a gap that is being lost between the youngsters and the mashayikh. And I'm not trying to be that middle person, but the reality is, I believe the mashayikh ain't given the opportunity or even the time and effort into the youngsters. And I feel like this is why they're going astray. And it is Islam is the only religion that brings different cultures, different races, and different people of knowledge based on their level all together in the same room.
Allah.
And that's based on character.
I always say that never underestimate the input of a person who's calling towards Allah. Not everyone's on the same level. Not everyone is aiming at a different, at the same category. So there are people I've seen who are scholars who feel threatened when someone comes, maybe with concentrating on a different subject, a different type of approach and so on. They feel threatened and they start, you know, hurting and hating. I mean, it's happened to you, it's happened to me, it's happened to a lot of us here.
No, definitely.
Where they don't see the importance. Like, for example, brother Wael Ibrahim, you know, he specializes in pornography. I mean, he specializes in the addictions, you know.
Okay.
He knows between us, we always tease each other, you know. I tell him, brother, you know what, it's X-rated, man, you know. And look, that topic is very important. I love him to be with me because while I tackle something, he tackles a different thing. And Sheikh Abu Bakr goes a little bit deeper into certain things. With yourself, you keep it light and you keep it colloquial. So you attract, you know, a different part of this. I love it. I love to see.
We were actually talking earlier, Sheikh Adnan, about how sometimes people who came from that background can relate to youngsters who are into this lifestyle today. And when they see that how Akhi Ayman, myself, was back in the days into music, singing, and other vices. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened doors and got us back to Islam, and now we are inviting those same people, sometimes they found these speakers more relatable than regular.
Just wanted to add to that, and I said this to the brothers, I think if Sheikh Adnan was in there, in the room in the back, sometimes I am very grateful for Jahiliyyah. Because if we didn't have Jahiliyyah, we wouldn't know what Islam would be. Jahiliyyah allows you to be grateful for that little buzz that you get from the moment you start practicing. And that's a buzz you would never get from smoking weed or from singing on stage or from dealing with pornography, I tell you that. But wallahi, I'm grateful for Jahiliyyah. Because Jahiliyyah gets you a long way. Wow. Alhamdulillah. And the companions, radiallahu anhu, look at their jahiliyyah they had. They were, you know, we were nowhere near them. But look at what Allah did for them. And look how Allah gifted them and honored them and used them as a tool to open up many doors for us. Alhamdulillah.
Sheikh Abu Bakr, I'm sure in Australia as well, there must be quite a similar setup where there are different categories of people and the youngsters, all sorts, and, you know, people, the da'is and the da'wah scene, and so on. A lot of different, I mean, you have different names and scholars who have different impacts. What's the experience you've had there?
When I in Australia, the one Sheikh Wael knows, the issues that are present in, for example, in America or in the UK are different to that in Australia. The Muslim community in Australia is a lot younger than the Muslim community. Islam came to Australia way after it was in the UK. And people are shallow. They don't have that depth in terms of understanding the differences of opinion among the different ideologies that are in Islam and so on. So, we tend to keep it natural. Just the fundamentals, the foundations of Islam. Try to teach that to the people, let them grasp that, understand something so that they can take back home, implement among their family, teach their family, this is how the level is among the Muslims in Australia. Oh, alhamdulillah. And,
I found here what I was surprised. I didn't know the amount of drugs, you know, the nightlife, the gangsterism. I was unaware of a lot of it. I mean, I've been coming for many, many years. I got married here maybe 30 years back. So I've been in and out of the country so much. In fact, you know, it's just the gift of Allah. We met lovely brothers who tell me, you know, you're unaware of this and that. And then I realized everywhere you go has a uniqueness to it. You need to know it. That's why when Akhi Ayman speaks, the way he speaks is just different, you know. He told me the other day, you know, he used some terminologies that I wouldn't have understood, no? My brother, beautiful terminologies. But alhamdulillah, it's really a good thing.
What is it? Why are you hiding the terminologies?
Why are you not telling us the terminologies?
Coming from a man that deals with pornography, I don't think it befits.
Addiction, brother. Always add the word addiction. Addiction. Otherwise, inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi
raji'un. Allahumma barik.
I just want to comment on the being grateful for your jahiliyyah. Because we don't want people to misunderstand what did you ask. So you're being grateful because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided you now. But we don't want those people who are still in that phase to be grateful now for what they're doing. Because
okay, so can I word it? Can I word it a bit better?
Yes.
Okay. Please. To say we are grateful for the hidayah after this jahiliyyah, so we appreciate it more. It's like saying I'm grateful for the cold because I know how the heat was. I'm grateful. So maybe the gratitude is for what we are in now rather than for what we were.
So when Allah you say enabled you to
when Akhi Ayman said I'm grateful for the jahiliyyah, what he meant is I'm grateful for being guided after that jahiliyyah, so I appreciate the guidance. Because wallahi, there are so many people who don't appreciate the deen of Allah. Some of what I said today, born Muslims sometimes are weak, so weak that they don't even realize how they need to practice. And then you have a revert coming and they're so serious about the deen because they've seen what's gone on the other side. So alhamdulillah, it's really, really good.
And hatta on this occasion, the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came out once to the companions, and they said, Ya Rasulullah, inna kunna fi jahiliyatin wa kufr. They said, O Messenger of Allah, we lived ignorant times and kufr. فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا بِهَذَا الدِّينَ And Allah Azza wa Jal gifted us this religion. So they acknowledged where they were and where they're at this moment. And that, yani, it's a moment for yourself to acknowledge where you are. And where you are at the moment.
Maybe Sheikh Adnan can comment on Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu wa in the first migration and how he addressed Al-Najashi the king.
And also he mentioned part of the past. What's interesting when it comes to the story of Ja'far radiallahu anhu as well as the other Sahaba radiallahu anhum is that they went through the difficulty, the hardship. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided them to Islam. And sometimes, Akhi Ayman was telling me this, we spoke about, sometimes after you guided, you go through these difficulties and hardships. So look, guidance came and then they migrated and they went through difficulty and then they had to migrate again and they had to migrate again. And this helped them, it increased their iman. So similarly, everybody who's on this journey, sometimes you might come to the deen, you want to change your life. You might go through some difficulty, but bear with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you and inshallah, you'll find yourself going from strength to strength.
No. That's just like Adam alayhi salam, who was in the paradise. Then he committed that disobedience when he ate from the tree. Then he made a tawbah. Then it was followed with a trial in where he was removed from the paradise to earth. That's a great trial. So the idea was, كمان يعني حتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم would say خياركم في الجاهلية إذا فقهوا يعني the best among you are those that lived that life of jahiliyyah, then they understood their deen and they implemented that deen. Because now, you know, a person that came from jahiliyyah and saw the light of Islam and remained steadfast, it's very difficult for him to go back to al-jahiliyyah because he knows that life. He hated it. Allah guided him out of it. He came to the light of Islam. But it's very easy for a person who has never lived al-jahiliyyah and has only known Islam and guidance for all his life to be tempted to go that way because he's never tasted it. He's never tried it. And so this is why yani, sometimes people that came from jahiliyyah to Islam can yani, have a lot more steadfastness than others. Because now they've experienced both worlds. They've seen here and the darkness of it and that there was no value in it. It gave nothing in life. Well, Islam and how much Islam gave them. And this is why the people, when they enter the paradise, they say, Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana li hadha. You know, Alhamdulillah that Allah Azza wa Jal guided us to Islam. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to continue to bestow His guidance upon us.
I would just like to add something to this because as a layman, I wanna understand because coming from people in my caliber, as a layman, we know there's a lot of jealousy
And I'm sorry to bring up this topic, but I feel like not a lot of people could have this opportunity. There's a lot of jealousy. What people need to understand, there was also jealousy amongst the people of knowledge, amongst the ulama. Like I believe we all live with jealousy within us. And it takes a true person, a true Muslim, to control that jealousy, like how you would control a person that's within a prison or an animal that's within a cage. You maintain it. You feed it enough to survive, but not you don't free it where it attacks people. So I just wanted to know from a layman's perspective, what's the situation within the jealousy? Because I see it quite a lot. And I know the mashayikh get it a lot. No. So where has it begun? And I know it's never going to end. So where should you balance yourself in this sector?
Did he say layman or Ayman?
Layman. Ayman the layman.
Alhamdulillah. You know, strange, you were saying that. I was just going to say, just before you said, I want to add something. I was going to say something on similar lines that today we're seated here. Wallahi, we're a few different people. I have managed to, you know, look at all those who are involved in da'wah as people who are helping me. And it's a fact. And so I will help them in whatever way I can. And there are people who really make your life difficult. They say things, you know, you have to sometimes not even respond. And if they have sincerity within them, they wouldn't publicly make, you know, statements and so on to say this and that. They would privately come and try and see and rectify, maybe misunderstanding, maybe correct. And one of the worst things is a lot of these people who don't have an understanding, they want all the scholars to be subservient either to them or to their sheikh, someone they look up to. Mm. And if you don't do that, and if you don't do exactly what they do, how they do it, and repeat and replicate only their little field that they're covering, they consider you a deviant. They don't realize that. The other day, I think I was talking to you and I was telling you that I've counted more than 75 different aspects of da'wah that the Prophet ﷺ engaged in. And we only do one or two. Someone teaches, someone, you know, there is visiting the sick, there is serving the widows, serving the orphans, to be an imam in the masjid, to be speaking to the Muslims, to speak to the non-Muslims, to be printing and publishing things and sending things across. One might argue the Prophet ﷺ didn't do that, but he sent letters to some of the other leaders and so on. And then there are so many departments. If you sit and count them, I can only do two of those maybe because of my weakness. If you're doing, why would you want me to do the same two? So we've only covered two in the Ummah, the other 68 or the other 70, no one's going to tackle them. You're a mature person who cares for the whole of the deen when you look at others and see that they are covering something I don't cover. Mm-hmm. They're taking care of an aspect that I don't take care of. And that's why with myself, I have Dr. Muhammad Salah, myself, Wael Ibrahim, we like to travel together because he covers something, I cover something, he covers something, complement each other, supplement each other, love each other, appreciate each other. Sheikh Abu Bakr, yourself, we appreciate everyone. Sheikh Adnan, you know, up and coming, the others. Everyone has their style, they cover a different thing. Similarly, we appreciate people who never do public speaking, but they're working hard in the masjid. They're working hard, for example, you have the Mu'adhin calling the Adhan. He's someone very important. You have people who are teaching at schools, who appreciates them. Sometimes they build people better than someone who speaks on the internet and is a big public speaker, well known. They're not known, but the impact they have, they're carving beautiful people by the help of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So yes, we have to control that jealousy when it comes. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, there are people who have managed it very well, but there are some, unfortunately, they cannot manage it. Even if they're very knowledgeable. I've come across a sheikh, a senior scholar who suffers with extreme jealousy in Saudi Arabia to the degree that he will block and stop others from doing da'wah simply because they're not subservient to him. And then you have blind followers of his who consider him a massive guy, not realizing he has a lot of goodness. We appreciate it. But do you believe he is a human with weaknesses that need to be rectified? If the answer is no, then you have a problem. And if the answer is yes, then help him. And that's the difference between the Muslimin. We don't have a hierarchy where the others are infallible. They, if they have a weakness, acknowledge, this is my sheikh. I've learned a lot from him, but there's 2-3 weaknesses he has. Then you're speaking.
No.
The problem is you have, I know, we were, myself, I was due to have some events somewhere, and someone came in and said something and did something, and I then turned the whole thing down and said, I'm not prepared to come. If you're prepared to fall into this type of a trap, I wouldn't like to be a part of it. I mean, why?
Mm.
So, and now, alhamdulillah, matters have become much better because things have eased up a little bit. People have realized, you know what, this is not the way. But there are still some, it's okay. Habibi, if I've told you, I'm telling you again, if you hear people online bashing you, thank Allah that you're doing something right. I told you that earlier this evening. I must have told that to you a few days ago as well. And when you hear people bashing you, you know, brother Akhi Ayman, the other day, greeted some brothers. It's happened to me too. They didn't reply him properly. They treat him like he's a non-Muslim as well. They might even call you a kafir, astaghfirullah, whatever. Take it in your stride. Habibi, leave it. You're doing something right. If they had a problem with the Prophet ﷺ, who am I? Who are you? They have a problem with Abu Bakr. Today, they have, radiallahu anh. They have a problem with Umar radiallahu anh. Who am I? I'm going to face more than that, man.
We need to eliminate some of our bad deeds through these kind of slanders. You know?
That doesn't mean I'm perfect. Yeah. I have my flaws and I'm open to correction. And so we all are. No. We make mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't, may Allah grant. I don't know where it started. It started, obviously, jealousy is a quality from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
People, I always say people are jealous of money and wealth. People are jealous of so many things, but even in knowledge, there's a lot of it. It's called the professional jealousy within the circles. Some people spend their entire lives printing things, publishing things, forwarding things, making videos, while the others are busy doing the hard work.
And I know of a man. I actually recorded a video today that I need to send to this man to ask or seek his approval to publish it. I was in the Philippines in a hotel room. The hotel was very humble, and he was in the room next to me, and he was charging his phone, apparently, and he was talking on his phone, and I could hear actually the conversation on the landline of my own phone in my own room. I could hear the whole conversation.
Wow.
And this man, despite mashallah, tabarakallah, the blessings that Allah had given him.
Oh, it's okay.
You know? I will not mention the man's name. You know him, I know him. And he was talking to those people that I never met, I never know, and pushing them to invite me because he believed in the ideas that I'm presenting. He doesn't need actually to go out of his way and promote somebody else other than himself. He's already popular, he's already loved by many people, you know, he doesn't have time for others. But actually this is what we have seen from other mashayikh on the opposite side. Some are jealous and trying to bash you down, but others will always try to lift you up.
I can quickly tell you something.
Can I publish the video, please?
he's let it out. Now he's talking about me, astaghfirullah alayhi. But you know what? I want to tell you a fact, Habibi. I found and I find that when you promote someone else, Allah promotes your work for you.
Allah.
Wallahi, I found that.
Allah.
When you promote others and you say, this guy, come on, you know, let's have a program with this brother, let's do this with this brother, come invite this guy. Anyone, and I find every time you invite someone, you promote someone, you say a good word about someone, wallahi, Allah does it for you. I found this happening, wallahi. And so I always say, no, lovely brother, oh, mashallah, amazing. They're doing good work, people are doing good work. Now, while Ibrahim covers a topic, it's hard for me to talk about some of the intimate things that he can easily just talk about in such a way that I've got to look down and think, shoo, did this man just say this, you know? But alhamdulillah, you've got to acknowledge it. I think we've spoken quite a bit. The tea is getting a bit cold. One more important question on
this matter. Yani, okay, so where does yani, refutation lie in all of this? Because then, of course, we know that at times someone might come and say something like really silly, it's got nothing to do with Islam, or perhaps like an extreme understanding about a certain matter, or, you know, just making all the opinions seem to be, there's only one opinion and this is it. There has to be some form of refutation.
Absolutely.
So where does this fit in all of this?
Can I say something about this? Dr. Zakir Naik and Sheikh Yasir Qadi, they published a video almost at the same time.
about the ruling on masturbation. Sorry, Sheikh Ayman, I have to bring this topic in.
Just a second. It's been a pleasure. We see pleasure in other ways.
This is the first time. This is the first time I'm meeting Ayman, and every time I talk, I mention porn addiction. And, but actually, these videos went viral because everyone is watching. Of course, Dr. Zak and I, very you know, heavyweight, mashallah, speaker, Sheikh Yasser and so on. So I actually made a video because that's my area of expertise. Is addiction, and I brought all the research, and wallahi, I was refuting, not the fiqhi issue, I'm not into this fiqhi matter, but I'm talking about the addictive part of the issue, if it is proven to be harmful and can actually prevent husbands and wives from having the halal intimacy and so on, then what would be the ruling? And I was trying to be as polite as possible to bring this into the public, not to, walayatu billah, bash these mashayikh. These people have been serving the deen for many, many years. Who am I to come and talk ill of them? So I think that this is what we need to learn. Is even if you want to refute or bring something to the public,
I agree with him, and I want to add something as well. It's important to refute. I've refuted many times. I abstain from mentioning names. The reason is, that same statement will be said by others at some point. If you've taken a name, you've created hatred towards the person regarding one matter you're refuting, and maybe that person has 99 other things better than yours in his own da'wah, and he's made one big mistake. So if you desperately need to mention a name because the fitna's too big, you can respectfully do so, I believe, because you're forced to, you have to, you respectfully do so. But personally, I have refuted in a way that many people would say this guy doesn't refute people. But I have this Mabalu Akwam policy. No. And the reason a lot of guys would probably repeat the thing. And if you've only tackled one, they might listen to the others that you haven't refuted. No. But by you doing ta'meem and addressing the subject, you've refuted anyone who's going to come in the future with a similar statement as well. So there is adab, the etiquette of refuting, but when you see someone talking, his face is, you know, looking aggressive, he wants to scream and yell and say, this guy is an idiot, and this guy, you know, he's immature, or he lacks knowledge, he lacks etiquette and respect. And there are some of the guys, they get very angry, they start swearing, they become abusive, and they say people's names, this guy's an idiot, this guy's a what. And the last thing I want to say is, I've come across people who've been cancelled because of 2-3 major things they've done. I have a habit, my brother, this guy, can I please work with him as a son and try to bring him back on? No, we've cancelled him, it's over. As though he's doomed to Jahannam. I believe as a father of children, as a grandfather, that if my kids make a blunder or a mistake, I should work with them and I can bring them back on board. I need to give them a second chance, a third chance, 10 chances. Maybe you don't bring the guy straight back onto the public platform, but can you not talk to him? Is he not a believer, you know, in the case that I'm talking about, but is he not someone who's worth investing in a little bit to try and bring him back on track? Or should we just leave them astray and make them go more astray? There's a few popular people who were just cancelled and so badly. And to be honest, I reached out to some of the guys and they were shocked, saying, you know, you're the only person who's actually come and say, I'd like to talk to you in a respectful, private, quiet way without anyone involved. Clear the matter. Let's clear the air. Today, we're living in an age of social media. People love to make videos. They'll take cameras, hidden cameras here and there. They'll go and I'll talk to you, purposely trying to belittle you so that they can make a video out of the scene. And they can actually come out and gain likes and whatever else and views and so on to make a big scene. This person is like this, like this, like this. And even in front of you, the aim is not to resolve the matter. It's just to show the public how stupid you are and how foolish you are. For me as a mu'min, that's not my aim. I don't want to show the public. I want to actually, between you and I, let's talk about something so that we can come back to the public and say, this brother made a few mistakes, he's apologized, and inshallah, you know what, he's changed his opinion. Alhamdulillah, it's a good thing. So it requires etiquette, but refutation is important because there are a lot of rubbish out there as well. Wallahu a'lam.
Just wanted to add to that. So it reminds you of the story of Abu Dhar and Bilal radiallahu anhu.
how the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the situation when he told Bilal radiallahu anhu, even you, you son of a black woman, you're disagreeing with me. How did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam deal with that? And how did he deal with it? Because if it gets to a stage and you're embarrassed to such a level and you're the companion, what did he do? He went and sought mercy from Bilal radiallahu anhu. He belittled himself to such a level, he put his head on the ground and said, yeah, Bilal, I'm not lifting this up until... if we were in this situation, someone comes to us, what would you do? I'm going to speak to myself. If I was having a bad day and my iman is low, I'm stamping out on your head. The reality was Bilal radiallahu anhu got on the floor and kissed his forehead. Which one are you? Are you the type of person that would use the opportunity to take your opponent down? That's your brother. And Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu is one of the best companions. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, you had traits of jahiliyyah within you. That doesn't make him a kafir. That doesn't make him a disbeliever. And look how he dealt with it. He dealt with it with good manners, good etiquettes, and wisdom. Everything in the deen has wisdom. It depends on your experience in life and your wisdom. Because you don't need knowledge on this, Sheikh. You don't need the knowledge to act like this.
Wallahi, we've had a very good session, Sheikh Abu Bakr. Some closing words, inshallah. Please.
Wallahi, barak fik. Allah Ta'ala. Good to be here.
This is called unplugged, Sheikh. Yeah,
this is called unplugged. We just talk amongst each other. You know what? And people can benefit. And inshallah, it's just cool, cozy and calm, Sheikh Adnan. We haven't heard much from you, Sheikh.
Only one thing I'd like to add on the same topic is, a lot of times people in the da'wah, and you spoke about when people attack with names, they lack vision a lot of the times. Why? Let's say someone repented later on. Brother, your video 5 years later is causing fitna on earth. And you may regret that, but then you've got followers. You've built a cult-like following. Sometimes you yourself want to distance yourself from the following, from what you said. But because it's already up there, it's all over the world, all over the internet, you can't take it down. So sometimes people die and, you know, wallahu alam, what goes on there, but they have this, this goes on, Allah, and it's a regret. So Allah protect one and all.
Thank you everyone for this input, and inshallah, we look forward to a beautiful few days ahead, inshallah.
Jazakallah
khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.